Students, this is a lecture series on arboviral hemorrhagic fever. Before we delve into the topic proper, it is worthwhile to note that hemorrhagic fevers are a group of illnesses causing vascular damage resulting in symptomatic bleeding or hemorrhages. These hemorrhages can occur under the skin, in the internal organs, or even from the external body orifices such as mouth, eyes, or ears. Apart from arboviruses, hemorrhagic fevers are caused by filoviruses such as Ebola and Marburg virus and rodent-borne viruses such as Hanta and arena viruses. Viral hemorrhagic fevers are generally geographically restricted to the areas where their host species live. Now, among the arboviral hemorrhagic fevers, I will be focusing most on dengue, chikungunya, and Kassanur forest disease, because all these three infections are commonly endemic in India. Dengue fever is caused by the dengue virus, which is an enveloped single-stranded RNA virus. This word dengue comes from the Swahili word dinga, which means fastidious or being careful, usually referring to the gait of a person suffering with bone pain of dengue fever. As is evident from this slide, you may note that there are lot of dengue viral infections reported every year till 2019. As of 2019, more than 1.37 lakh cases were reported with over 130 deaths. Dengue viruses have got several serotypes, 1 to 4. The fifth serotype has recently been discovered in 2013 from Bangkok. All these four serotypes have different subtypes, and all these serotypes and subtypes are distributed throughout the 31 states and union territories in India, mostly in urban cities and towns. As is evident from this map, the serotype distribution generally do not have a specific geographical distribution, a pattern, but it is seen throughout India. However, it is useful for epidemiological surveillance purposes to determine the nature of the clinical infections and also the prognosis to the treatment of infections. Dengue is transmitted primarily by the Aedes mosquito. There is an Aedes aegypti mosquito, which is a much more efficient vector than Aedes albopticus, because it bites repeatedly more than once to have a complete blood meal. Now, how does this mosquito-man cycle operate in dengue virus? Dengue virus, which is present in the patient's blood, usually up to 5 days following the infection, is called as the viremic phase. It is during this viremic phase that the person is usually susceptible to the transmissibility of this dengue virus. So a mosquito, an Aedes mosquito, which feeds this person during the viremic phase of his illness, acquires the virus and undergoes a period of an extrinsic incubation for up to 8 to 10 days, during which the virus multiplies in the mosquito. Subsequently, when the this mosquito bites or refeeds another human, it undergoes an intrinsic incubation period. The virus undergoes an intrinsic incubation period within the second host, following which the person develops a viremia. Once this infected mosquito bites, the Langerhans cells and the dendritic get infected. They transport the viral virus to the regional lymph nodes, and from there the dendritic cells are infected and they transport in the bloodstream, resulting in the viremia. Following viremia, clinical disease results, and depending on where the virus goes and gets lodged, the symptoms manifest. In the skin, the patient will develop rashes. If the virus is present in the joints, the patient develops arthritis, or in the nervous system, the patient develops encephalitis. So there is a urban cycle and there is a sylvatic cycle. The fifth dengue virus serotype usually follows this sylvatic cycle between the mosquito vector and the monkeys. Here, the human becomes the accidental host. Several clinical classifications are present for dengue fever. The latest classification is made as late as 2009. But before we go to the latest classification, it is useful to understand three clinical entities, that is the dengue fever, the dengue hemorrhagic fever, and dengue shock syndrome. Because if we have a basic understanding of these three entities, the newer classification is nothing but a remodeling or repackaging of the various signs and symptoms present under these entities. So, you have two types of infection. You have a primary dengue infection and a secondary dengue infection. In the primary dengue infection, the person gets infected with any one serotype of dengue virus for the first time. Following months, a more severe form of dengue illness occurs. This is called a secondary dengue infection, and this occurs because of infection with another serotype which is different from the first serotype causing primary infection. Your dengue fever causes primary infection, and dengue hemorrhagic fever and dengue shock syndrome are manifestations of the secondary dengue infection. So, a person having a dengue fever is characterized by a breakbone type of fever. You have fever with bone pains, also called as biphasic fever, sometimes also referred to as saddleback fever, associated with headaches, muscular pain, rash, and leukopenia. Now, when a person with dengue fever has hemorrhagic manifestations with thrombocytopenia and evidence of elevated hematocrit, low albumin, and pleural or other effusion, he is categorized as having dengue hemorrhagic fever. So, there are four grades of dengue hemorrhagic fever. You have grade 1, where you see fever and symptoms with a positive tourniquet test that is greater than 20 petechial spots per square inch area in cubital fossa, with spontaneous bleeding from, only positive tourniquet test. In grade 2, there is spontaneous bleeding from the skin, nose, mouth, and gums. In grade 3, along with spontaneous bleeding, the patient will have signs of circulatory failure with rapid or weak pulse, narrow pulse pressure, hypotension, and cold clammy skin. And in grade 4, there will be a profound shock with an undetectable pulse and BP. In dengue shock syndrome, All the four criteria of dengue hemorrhagic fever are present with evidence of circulatory failure, as evidenced by rapid and weak pulse, narrow pulse pressure, cold, clammy skin, and altered mental status along with shock. So this is your latest classification, where you basically categorize the patients into two types. One is dengue with or without warning sign, and then you have patients with severe dengue. So any patient who has traveled to a dengue endemic area is classified as having a probable dengue infection if he has fever with constitutional symptoms, nausea, vomiting, joint pains, and a positive tourniquet test. There is a new entity here of lab-confirmed dengue, when even if there is no sign of plasma leakage, the patient has got a positive dengue antibody as evidenced by the ELISA testing. So a person is called as having a warning sign when the person has abdominal pain or tenderness with persistent vomiting, mucosal bleeding, hepatomegaly, increased hematocrit, and decrease in platelet count. Those with warning systems require observation in the inpatient departments or in the OP, require IP admissions. Severe dengue is a category where your dengue hemorrhagic fever minus the tourniquet test along with dengue shock syndrome fall under. So here there are signs of severe plasma leakage leading to shock and fluid accumulation, severe bleeding, and organ involvement with elevated liver enzymes and impaired consciousness. Before we understand the reasons for severity in the dengue infection, we need to know the concept of antibody-dependent enhancement. So here basically there are two types of antibodies. There is a neutralizing antibody and a non-neutralizing antibody. The neutralizing antibodies are basically produced against the serotype which causes that infection, and they are usually lifelong. But having said that, cross-protection to other serotypes do exist, but they diminish over a period of few months. So all those neutralizing antibodies are not able to, which bind to the virus, are not able to initiate the infection. And basically they are much more protective. The neutralizing antibodies are protective and they do not initiate a viral infection in the host. Whereas if you look at the non-neutralizing antibodies, they are not produced against the infective serotype, but they are produced against the other serotypes other than the infecting serotypes. So here, what happens is, these non-neutralizing antibodies, when they bind to the second serotype or to secondary serotypes, instead of neutralizing them, because they are basically directed against these secondary serotypes, they protect these secondary serotypes from host immune response and inhibit the B cell activation. So what happens here is, these non-neutralizing antibodies, instead of protecting the host, release the cytokines and causes severe secondary dengue infection. This pattern is usually observed when serotype 1 infection is followed by serotype 2 infection, which is much more severe than the other four serotypes which are present. So how do we diagnose this infection in the lab? In the viremic phase, within the first 5 days of the onset of symptoms, real-time PCR targeting the specific region is much more diagnostic. This is the most sensitive test during the first 5 days of infection with specificity of 95%. Real-time PCR can be used to detect the serotypes and also to quantify the viral load in the blood. Suppose the patient reports or reaches the OP after the 5 days, then we resort to antibody detection methods and the antigen detection methods. The antigen that is detected is the NS1 antigen or the non-structural protein 1 antigen. This antigen has is detectable from day 1 of the fever for up to 18 days, and it is very highly specific because it can differentiate between the flaviviruses. That means if a person has NS1 antigen positive, we can be definitively sure that this person has got a dengue viral infection. But mind you, this NS1 antigen positivity is usually seen only in the primary cases of dengue infection or lab confirmed cases of dengue infection. If it is seen only, because this virus lasts only for up to 18 days. Even it can be seen in the secondary infection, but there we rely more on the antibodies, that is the IgM and the IgG antibodies. For primary infection, your IgM antibody appears 5 days after fever and lasts for up to 90 days, whereas IgG is present from 14 to 21 days after fever and slowly decreases. Usually, the IgG antibody titers are seen more with the secondary dengue cases. And it is only during the secondary dengue infection that this particular, you know, test result can become cross-reactive with other flaviviruses, giving false positive results. So, in contrast to the IgG in secondary infection, IgM titer is very, very low. So, there is a very recently developed IgM capture ELISA testing by the National Institute of Virology, Pune, which can specifically detect the IgM antibodies and cross-reactivity of this particular test with the other flaviviruses is also minimal when compared to the other test. Then you have neutralization tests like plaque reduction assays available, which are much more specific, but they are much more cumbersome, so we generally don't do it. Rapid diagnostic testing is also available for the NS1 or IgM antigen, but if a person is positive by a rapid diagnostic test, he or she must be definitely subjected to the antibody detection test, ELISA test also, for further confirmation. So, to capture the essence of diagnostics of dengue virus in a nutshell, you have the RT-PCR test, which is done within the 5 days of the viral illness. Post 5 days, we rely on three parameters: NS1 antigen, IgM and IgG. Usually, NS1 antigen positivity indicates a primary dengue infection, but it can also be seen in patients who are having fever for up to 18 days. So, treatment, there is no specific treatment as in the case of the other hemorrhagic fever arboviruses, much more symptomatic in the form of replacing the fluid loss and electrolyte imbalance disturbances, and also to provide platelet transfusion, which usually is seen following severe plasma leakage resulting in shock or fluid loss. So, there is a recent vaccine called Dengvaxia approved for dengue virus. Several viruses, vaccine candidates are there under trial, but this particular viral vaccine commercially marketed by Sanofi Pasteur is a chimeric yellow fever dengue live attenuated tetravalent vaccine, which is employed or directed to patients between the age group of 19 to 45 years. So we can administer 3 doses of the virus subcutaneously at intervals of 6 months. Those people who are having allergic reactions to the vaccine and immunodeficient in pregnant and breastfeeding women are contraindicated from taking the vaccine. This vaccine has got an efficacy of 80%. Currently, WHO has recommended this vaccine in high burden countries with zero prevalence of more than 70%. But it also cautions that this vaccine should be used only in those people who are previously infected with this dengue virus, because those people who are not infected with dengue viruses can develop subsequent infections following the viral administration. So therefore, because of these safety issues, it is not available in India, and currently it is restricted to Mexico, Philippines, Brazil, Indonesia, Thailand and Singapore. So chikungunya fever is basically a re-emerging disease. Initially, this particular virus was noted in Malaysia in the year 1991. Subsequently, the outbreak in the French Reunion Island in the Indian Ocean in the year 2005 actually captured the attention of the world community, because almost one third of the country's population were affected by this particular virus. There were subsequent outbreaks in Mauritius, Madagascar, Seychelles, and in India there were outbreaks in 2005 till 2017. And even compared to dengue virus, currently the cases of chikungunya viruses are much more lesser in India. So currently the virus is the reasons for the emergence or the large outbreak in the Reunion Island is believed to be because of the mutation taking place in the chikungunya virus in the 266 position of the E1 glycoprotein gene, where alanine was replaced by valine, and also for the due to the presence of the new vector Aedes albopticus when compared to that of the Aedes aegypti. So this particular virus is maintained again in an urban cycle and a sylvatic cycle. The sylvatic cycle is between the monkeys and the forest species, whereas the urban cycle is between the human and the Aedes mosquito. Chikungunya is an infection which is derived from the word kungunyala, which means the person bends or gets folded up. So if you look at the clinical features, the patient here will have migratory polyarthritis affecting small joints of wrist and ankle, which is more severe in the morning, along with fever. So when compared to that of dengue virus, in chikungunya virus the bone pain is much more severe than that of the dengue virus, and it lasts much more longer than that of the dengue virus. And also, along with bone pain, the patient will have leukopenia. In the acute infection, the IgM antibodies are detected between 4 days to 3 months. In those with chronic infections, the IgG antibodies are detected between 2 weeks to many years. Again, real-time PCR is employed for detection of the specific gene, the chikungunya gene, NSP1 NSP4 in the blood. Like in dengue, there is an IgM antibody capture ELISA available for the chikungunya virus also. So to summarize the clinical features, you have an acute stage of migratory polyarthritis and a chronic joint pain lasting for months to a year. Usually this particular infection is noted in the extremes of the age group, that is in the newborn and in those older than 65 years, and those with underlying hypertension and diabetes or heart disease. So there are hematological parameters, predominantly leukopenia along with thrombocytopenia with elevated ESR and CRP. So the treatment is basically symptomatic and supportive. Caesonore forest disease is identified in 1957 from monkeys from the Caesonore forest in the Shivamogga district of Karnataka, India. It is an enveloped single-stranded RNA virus transmitted by the heart ticks belonging to the genus Haemophysalis pinigera. Usually the host are monkeys, rodents and squirrels, and normally the infection is restricted within the forest between the animal tick and the animal cycle. So unlike in the Japanese encephalitis virus where the pigs are the amplifier host, in KFD the monkeys are the amplifier host. KFD has been reported in dry months, that is between November to June, where humans increasingly undertake this trekking activities. Currently it is endemic in 5 districts of Karnataka, that is Shivamogga, North Kannada, South Kannada, Chikkamagaluru and Udupi districts. Currently, because of the vaccination, the disease trends have been much more lower when compared to the previous years. Usually the incubation period is for 2 to 7 days with fever, headache and myalgia along with prostration. Severe cases will have hemorrhages or bleeding tendencies from the nasal cavity, throat, gum and also gastrointestinal bleeding. Complicated usually by neck stiffness, mental retardation and giddiness. The mortality rate is around 5 to 10%. The risk factors, as I mentioned previously, is because of the trekking activities or close contact in the forest area with the forest fauna. There is an NIV or National Institute of Virology approved formalin inactivated chick embryo tissue culture vaccine available, which is given for 2 doses over an interval of 2 months. The booster dose is given at 6 to 9 months and every 5 years. So the best way to control it is to avoid entering into the tick infested forest and also using tick repellents for dengue and chikungunya viruses. Please also remember that vector control measures should also be adopted, which includes spraying the insect repellents like DDT and also using mosquito nets and full sleeve shirts. Thank you for your patient listening.